And the launch of the Council for Supplier Diversity.
Come on, pass it,
UK.
Sort of take her region.
Should I please ask everybody to mute their mics as we start? So if my team can actually mute people as well, that'd be much appreciated. So hi, my name is Kerry Hallard. I'm the Chief Exec of the Global Sourcing Association, and as I say, delighted to welcome you here to the Festival of Sourcing. The Festival of Sourcing is a series of 30 events that the GSA has put on as we do two main things. One, we celebrate the success of our industry, specifically in response to COVID. The industry performed incredibly well. Trust in relationships and collaboration really came to the fore. So one, we wanted to celebrate the industry, but to look at a very strong vision for the future of the industry, and I've put on a series of 30 events which are covering everything that we believe to be hot topics for our membership community for 2021 and beyond. And of course, supplier diversity is one of them. It's an incredibly important subject. It's a subject that the people that are joining me here today are incredibly passionate about, so we're going to be delighted to explain what the background to the Council for Supplier Diversity UK is, why we're here, what we're trying to achieve, and really what we want to do is get some interaction. We really want to discuss this subject with each and every one of you, so please do use the chat box as much as possible, and please do obviously tweet and get this discussed on social media. So the backdrop to this is, it's really, I would like to say we were having conversations down the pub. We weren't having conversations down the pub, but we were having conversations online with each other. So Sunita Hirani is a senior contracts manager at the BBC, and she's also a member of the GSA Council. So Sunita and I were having a conversation. Sunita was saying that she's in charge of the supplier diversity programme at the BBC, but can find no best practice. Is there a body of work that she could tap into via the GSA? I was just like, unfortunately, no. Simultaneously, I was having conversations with Farida Gibbs. Farida Gibbs is the chief exec of Gibbs Hybrid, and I'll let them introduce themselves in more detail shortly. And Farida and I have been talking about, you know, the challenges of working with SMEs, working with diversities, and the challenges Farida faces. And it's just like, right, we really should be doing something to level the playing fields here. And I realised there was obviously a clear connect. And I know Farida had been having conversations with Sara, Ahmad, who's at Bristol Myers Squibb. And it was just sort of like, right, there's a real issue here. And we all then started talking to each other. We've had God knows how many meetings and conversations, and then pulling in a broader community to actually discuss the issue of supplier diversity. And from that, it's very clear that there's a real challenge and a real opportunity. So that's what we're here to discuss today. But without further ado, what I'd like to do is ask each of my colleagues to introduce themselves and give a little bit of background. So just a quick hello, and then I'll go on to some conversations. So Sunita, if you'd like to introduce yourself.
Thank you. And thank you for that, Kerry. Yes, my name is Sunita Hirani, and I am a senior contract manager at the BBC, as Kerry has already highlighted there. But I do have a firm passion for diversity and inclusion. And that kind of just led me to thinking, what could I do with my passion and my career experience, which is predominantly in supplier management, and really marry the two and drive forward this supplier diversity. So I'm also a supplier diversity lead within the BBC, and talking to and networking with a lot of professionals who are looking at the same thing. But yeah, me.
Thank you, Sunita. Farida, could you please do the honours?
Good morning, everyone. Yeah, my name is Farida Gibbs. I'm the CEO and founder of Gibbs Hybrid. We're an international IT and business services firm. Very proud to always share that we are Europe's largest minority woman-owned business. It's taken 16 years to get to that accreditation, but very proud to be here. My background is really predominantly was in HR before I moved into the services sector. And later on, share with you, obviously, the challenges that as a diverse supplier that I have encountered over the 16 years and finally saying that actually something needs to be done. You know, we need to create some change. And I often share and listen to many other diverse businesses and their challenges. And very proud that, you know, we will be launching SD UK. So nice to be here. Thank you, Kerry.
Okay, and last but not least, Sara.
Hi, good morning, everyone. So I'm Sara Ahmad. I'm the procurement head at Bristol Myers Squibb for UK and Ireland. I'm also the European lead for supplier diversity across all our markets. And then I sit on the board of directors for MSD UK, as well as the council for We Connect. So hopefully you can tell from that I've got a lot of passion and time for supplier diversity. And it really came about from a conversation, as Kerry said, with Farida and I, where we were looking at, well, where is the corporate-to-corporate network and where do corporations go when they really want to put together a rich programme that really talks to all sorts of diverse groups? And that's where the conversation started. And from there, we worked together to bring this council and to also bring on additional members as well. So hopefully this will be an exciting conversation.
Okay, thank you. Thank you all. Right, Farida, I would like to start with you. So as you said, obviously 16 years in the making, but now you are leading Europe's largest ethnic minority female-owned business. Could you give us a bit of a backdrop about some of the challenges you might have faced along the way and what you think, you know, other minority-owned diverse suppliers might be facing today?
Yeah, thanks, Kerry. Yeah, so I think for me, I've been part of the MSD UK and We Connect international bodies for about 10 or 11 years now. And before getting into that, I had to ask myself, and like many other diverse businesses, was what is this accreditation going to do for me? I was always very concerned that by being labelled an ethnic minority business or being labelled a woman-owned business would actually pigeonhole me. And after multiple conversations, I took a leap of faith and I could actually see the power of those platforms and what they could do. But I think, you know, along my journey, it's always been in the back of my mind, you know, because I'm diverse, because I'm a woman, because I'm of an ethnic minority background, is that stopping Gibbs Hybrid from bigger and greater things? And what tends to happen is there is great intent from procurement, there is great intent from sourcing professionals. They want to create change. I think that they just have struggled with how to create the change. So over the last 10, 11 years, I've had multiple conversations. I have had multiple meetings. I have had so many opportunities to present, but those opportunities have kind of stopped. And it stopped because those buyers haven't been able to bring in those opportunities to the table. And you know, and what I have found is where those businesses or those corporations have been able to invite me and the company to an RFP, for example, we've worked really, really hard. But where it really stops for us is it doesn't matter how great the RFP scaling and metrics and scoring becomes, somebody ultimately has to own that relationship. Somebody has to make that decision. And I think, you know, my experience has always been that, you know, we've lost out many times because we're not a big global corporation. We're not a large strategic supplier. We are potentially seen as risky because we are much smaller. So those have been multiple challenges, but by going through the platforms with WeConnect and with MSD UK and having conversations with procurement professionals who are very passionate about supply diversity, those 10 years have led us to have some great wins. And but it's not through the want of, you know, sort of having to sort of really go in and have multiple discussions and really sell who you are, what you do, what you can bring to the table. And often I find that I have to have 10 conversations, whereas a major competitor of mine might only have one or two because they're well known, they're well renowned, that they everybody knows who they are. But whereas I have to keep selling my company, I have to keep selling my business, I have to keep selling, you know, why we are better than our competitors. So those challenges still exist today, and it is through those challenges that I personally felt that something has to change, because we will be here in another 5 years, 10 years time, still talking about supply diversity, still talking about the challenges that those diverse businesses face, but actually nothing is going to change. And what really stood out for me was when I was at a big conference, a big diverse conference, and there was about 10 of us that sat around the table, and everybody was having a real sort of moan. You know, they sort of walk around the conference, go and like talk to the corporations and everything else. But then, you know, these businesses sat on a table and started to really vent their frustrations. And this was the first time that I was actually hearing this. And what was surprising was that there was actually a corporate on that table that we didn't know, that was sat there listening to all of these businesses vent. And it was very apparent to me that clearly it wasn't just me who was feeling quite frustrated and that something needed to change. So, you know, it is getting better, but I'm not actually sure that in my lifetime we will get to where we need to be. So I'm here, obviously, as part of SD UK, really trying to create some change and really trying to drive and make things happen. I think that's what we need. We need to get to the how and how to create that.
Okay, it's staggering, isn't it, really, that there are these challenges, and we will come and discuss these challenges in a little bit more detail over the course of this session. But now I'd like to move across to you, Sunita. Obviously, you're coming at this from a very, very different perspective. You're coming at it as being a buyer. What are the blockers? Why is Gibbs Hybrid finding it so much harder to break through than they really should?
And you know, it's quite insightful to hear Farida's experience there as well. And it's not an experience that she's having in isolation. There are many, many cases. But if I can just step back and just kind of share the experiences from a buyer, from a BBC perspective, that would be really great. So, as resonates with many people here, you know, diversity includes everyone. And at the BBC, we believe in the heart of everything we do. It's our creative future. It's our public service remit depends on it. Our audience expects it, and we are committed to it as well. You know, we've got a lot of investment of time and resources that are heavily involved in working to a better BBC with diversity and inclusion at the heart of it. This has meant that we're reviewing a lot of strategies and a lot of the ways that we work. But, you know, and the diversity strategy within the BBC has been a primary focus across the entire organisations. And it's a clear prioritisation, you know, in the media out there as well, across the organisation. However, we did recognise that we hadn't necessarily included it in our procurement, in our supply base. So Supplier Diversity Programme is a significant opportunity for any procurement in any organisation. But for us in the BBC, we recognise that diversity is not only within our content that we put out there to our audiences, but it's within the core of the BBC. And this acknowledges this acknowledges who we do business with as well. So the journey has begun, and I know that sounds cliche, but the journey has begun, and it's brought many challenges. Definition for one, and I think a lot of people, that will resonate with everybody. All of the considerations, the compliances, geographies, demographics, culture. The biggest discovery for me was the knowledge gap. When I started drafting our supplier diversity programme of work. And I felt that this needs education, it needs empathy, it requires a great deal of networking, researching. And I think one thing that a lot of my colleagues and networks and professionals here today will recognise is that there is an established best practice across the pond in the US, but we also know, those of us that have attempted or are doing executing a program of work in supply diversity, that it's not as simple as just using that best practice. So it's been difficult to find that level of best practice in the UK to be applied here before we even look into any other geographies. The obvious challenge, and that a lot of people might recognise, is of course buy-in, and the action that is likely to cause in sort of established processes and the way people work. Luckily, though, through some persistence, and alignment to our overarching D&I. Focus at BBC, I'm able to drive that forward. So that's a little bit of background there at what's going on at BBC.
Okay, thanks, Sunita. And I'd like to pick up, you know, how you're going to be addressing it in a moment. But you made a very interesting point, and that is that you can't just lift and shift this from the US. So that makes me come straight to you, Sara, because I know that BMS has got a great program in the US, and it seems sensible for me that you just replicate what they've been doing, but you can't, can you? Can you explain a little bit more about their program and why it's not feasible to just do the same here?
Sure, absolutely. So let me start just by saying a bit about what BMS does, and then our program, and then I'll flip over to what we're doing outside of the US and some of the challenges we're facing in the UK. So Bristol Myers Squibb, you may know, we basically discover, develop and look into innovative medicines that really help patients who have quite serious diseases. And as part of that, diversity and inclusion is a really important part of our mission, because we feel that it reflects the communities that we really want to serve. And supplier diversity really brings in that agility and that innovation into our organization, but it also helps to create that wealth for our diverse suppliers and our communities. The program in the US, as Sunita sort of alluded to, because they have government guidelines and targets to meet, our program's actually been in place for the last 25 years, but it's really only in the last 6 years that we've really started to expand that outside and to go beyond just inviting diverse suppliers into our pitches, but really to start looking into the communities and looking at how do we support those communities. So we, in the US, we go across all the different diverse groups, from women-owned to small businesses to LGBT to disabled veteran and beyond. And there's a number of aspects to the US program. So as I said, it does start with our category management and ensuring that when we have new sourcing activities, we have a database of diverse suppliers that we can reach out to. But then beyond that, we've got our development initiative, which really talks to supporting small and diverse organizations through various mentoring and scholarship programs. And I'll touch a bit more on the scholarship in particular further on. Then we've also got our sort of what we call our Power to Impact Communities programme. And this really looks at how do we sponsor activities and events that happen in local communities that really support those people. And so far, we've tried to impact around 10,000 people in various communities across the US. We also collaborate with our policymakers in the US. So we join up with various advocacy groups, and we really try to push the supplier diversity agenda onto the federal policymakers. And we're starting in New Jersey and Pennsylvania, where our offices are currently, to really try and make a difference and have the state understand what the needs of diverse and small businesses are. We, of course, ensure that when we're employing people into BMS, that we're expanding that diverse employer base that we bring in, because we know that when you have a diverse employee base, you bring in a much more richer pool of talent. And with that comes all those amazing ideas as skills that they bring in as well. Then we've also got our group, which really looks at enhancing the supply chain. So it's not just about who we work with, but then it's also about the supply chain that our diverse suppliers have as well. And in the US, we're really trying to bring in some health equity, because we understand there is disparity between in the health sector. And we're trying to see how we can give as many opportunities to people in those different communities through the drugs that we have available as well. So we've expanded our footprint outside of the US, and we've gone mostly into Brazil, Canada, the UK and Ireland. And outside of that now, we have champions in each of the markets to really try to expand that program out. But back to your question, you asked, you know, why can't we just lift and shift? You've got an amazing program that's already established with all these different elements. Why not just copy it over here? And I think there's a few things to note when we start to look at our programs locally. So part of it is understanding, well, what is diverse? What does diversity mean in our local market? And having that definition locally appropriate as well. So we're going through that process at the moment to agree with our legal teams and with our organization. What do we mean by diverse suppliers? What are the groups that are available that are already established in the local marketplace? And what are the groups that need some additional support that maybe haven't formed themselves as yet, but how can we still be as inclusive as possible to those groups? We're also looking at how do we expand outside of just asking suppliers to pitch on tenders? Because as Sunita said, that's one part of it. But there's also the additional programs like the mentoring and the scholarship. And one of the things that we did from the US, which I was super excited to be able to attend, was at the MSD Innovation Context a couple of years ago, we sponsored a number of individuals to go to the Tuck School of Business in the US. And for a week, they were able to do an intensive MBA course. And what that meant for these individuals was that they were able to put together their business plan so that when they came back, they could actually launch their business. And that's the additional support that a lot of our diverse and small businesses need, is they've got these amazing ideas, they know what they want to do, but it's really how do they approach the corporate world. And quite often when I attend, you know, MSD UK or We Connect or other events, I often hear diverse suppliers asking me the same thing. How do we approach a corporate organization? How do we work with your legal team, your finance team, your commercial team? So part of what we've been doing is actually opening those doors and allowing those conversations to happen. So I've introduced diverse suppliers to our finance team, to our HR team, to our legal team, to really just have that conversation and help them prepare, because I fully appreciate that a lot of our diverse suppliers don't have the support that the support network around them to give them all those different skills and information. And you may have seen in the press that we've actually publicly announced that our CEO Giovanni has committed that we're going to spend $1 billion with diverse suppliers before 2025. And I'm so pleased to hear that public announcement, because that really then instills in everybody at BMS how important supplier diversity is, and how we want to really make a difference in this space. So that's why we will be expanding our programme to all our offices globally. So that's across Asia, Europe and the Middle East as well, and Africa. So hopefully that's given you a bit of insight into the programme and then into some of the challenges that we're facing. But I do think that we can take some of the learnings that we have from the US, and particularly around some of the programs that we've put in place. And we have tried to start by supporting the organizations that are already available here. But at the same time, I think we just need to make sure that whatever we adapt over here really is relevant for the needs and the teams and suppliers that we have available here.
No, that's absolutely brilliant. Thanks very much for sharing all of that with us. It's really, really comprehensive. It has inspired a couple of questions, and I'm unfortunately have to put my glasses on to actually be able to read the text of those questions. And I do want to take the questions as we go, because I want to keep this as interactive as possible. But I do want to then pick back up on the challenges in a minute. So this is from Manuela. What systems do you use globally to manage your database of diverse suppliers? One of the key challenges is the access to diverse suppliers globally. Well, we recognise that, don't we? So who would like, Sara, Sossi, would you like to take that first? And then maybe you, Sunita, as well.
Yeah, sure. And apologies, everyone. My network is terrible because I have three kids are homeschooling at the moment and we're all fighting for the bandwidth. And that's one of the areas that, you know, we're really trying to expand is in the database. So we do have a database that we sort of manually track at the moment, but we do also have we can use to as part of our sourcing process, so that every time in the US somebody goes out for a sourcing activity, they're able to show why they are using a diverse supplier, which diverse supplier they're using. And if they can't, then we're also tracking the reasons why our sourcing managers aren't able to use diverse suppliers. And then that gives us an indication of which categories do we need to go out and find diverse suppliers for or support those communities further.
Yeah, just to add to that, we will be looking to use the existing contract management database that we have, supplier management database that we have, but just trying to customize what we've got. But there are more and more that I'm networking, researching, there are more and more systems that are being exposed or recognized, and that we're talking to more and more people that are looking to deliver exactly to that. So we will be looking to encompass that, the outputs that this council hopes to deliver in terms of corporate space. So watch this space.
Okay, thank you. So let's carry on focusing on the challenges. Some of the work of the GSE has been to develop an SME code of conduct, and that's because we know a lot of the smaller players were finding it incredibly difficult to engage with enterprise buyers. So, you know, the due diligence process, they can't even get their foot over the door with some due diligence processes because their turnover isn't big enough, they're seen as being far too risky to work with. The contracting is just so complicated, you know, 160 page contracts that they need to go through the RFP process, as Farida talks about. There's so many different hurdles and blockers in place. Farida, actually, do you want to talk a little bit more about the challenges? And then Sunita and Sara, could you give a response as to how you think you're changing so that you can let more smaller players and other diverse suppliers work with the BBC and BMS?
Yeah, thanks, Kerry. I think the first thing that for me personally is to try and remove the word small, because as soon as we're labeled small, it just leaves this perception that we're not able to scale or that we are not big enough. So the challenge is trying to accept that capability is the most important thing, and then determining how can a diverse business scale if we are not quite at the level that maybe that corporate wants. So, but there are a lot of passionate sourcing and procurement professionals out there. I've met most of them, and they are able to bring their passion and to hold lots of diverse one-to-one meetings, general corporate meetings, supply diversity meetings, bringing the execs in, bringing key stakeholders and buyers. We attend those meetings. The passion is definitely there. Then what you'll see is then there's an opportunity to then get a contract in place should an opportunity arise. And I think that the biggest challenge is once that contract is in place, is how do we sort of touch on the key stakeholders? because there's a representative or in many sort of organisations or big corporations that will do exactly that will go out, look for those diverse suppliers, do everything that they can to bring them in. But once we're signed up, you know, I feel that the challenge is how to navigate us into the business, how to get those buyers or those stakeholders to understand what diversity and supply diversity actually really means when they're making those decisions, because it has to be across the organisation. Everybody has to understand why supply diversity is important, not just procurement, not just sourcing, and not just the supply diversity rep. You know, there are stakeholders who buy services, there are stakeholders who buy products. If they don't understand why there is such a mission or an intent to spend the amount of money to bring diverse companies into the supply chain, then it won't succeed, because you're going to identify them, you're going to bring them in, but that spend isn't going to really happen. So you know, and I've seen it on quite a few occasions with Gibbs Hybrid, where, you know, there are many procurement professionals who are absolutely passionate about supply diversity, have brought us in and then left us to it, but we haven't been able to win over those stakeholders in the same way, because one, they're far too busy, two, they haven't got time to sit and have a meeting about another firm, and three, they just need to get the job done. So often they will go with those partners that they have already had relationships with, that they've already done business with. So the challenge is how do you bring in diverse suppliers into the mix? How do we convince the business that we are worthy of doing business with? And how do we make sure that all that hard work that all these procurement professionals and sourcing professionals do, they spend a lot of time on it, doesn't get unpicked to find that all that hard work has just gone out of the door because a new person has come into the organisation and decided that they're not interested in supply diversity, just want to work with the top three global strategic suppliers in the world. What do you do in that instance? And so, yes, there's challenges, but with the same breath, because I'm really passionate about this, is that it's not all doom and gloom, and there has been great success, and there have been amazing corporations that have seen that the hard work pay off and have been able to succeed with bringing in diverse suppliers that have made contributions and brought in some change and is a breath of fresh air. Because sometimes you often hear that the big strategic suppliers, the well-known brands, become complacent, and they're not challenged and they need to be given a bit of a run for their money. So you will get companies, diverse companies, that will come in and absolutely put their hands in their pockets, do the investment, build teams, because we know we can do it. It's a tough one, but yeah, and that's why I guess we're all here talking about it, talking about the challenges, but more importantly, what are we going to do to change it?
Yeah, and of course there are huge benefits. So to talk about another fabulous pharmaceutical company, GSK, they have a fantastic story where they dropped market share from fifth position to ninth globally, and they did a very introspective review as to what was going wrong, and a lot of it was down to the way that they were engaging only with really, really large suppliers, that they weren't able to be innovative and agile enough to bring new products to market quite as quickly as some of their competitors, especially when digital deregulation happened. So they did a wholesale review of the way that they sourced, and their contracts went from 160 pages to 4 pages, their payment terms went from 90 days to on average 14 days, and their RFPs weren't allowed to take any longer than 6 weeks. So that made it a playing field that smaller companies really wanted to, one, work with them, but two, were able to work with them. Now, I know there's a similar story, and it's a very controversial move at the time at the BBC, Sunita, when the Met Office was replaced, obviously, as being the weather forecasting that the BBC had used for years, with a really small company of a handful of people based in New Zealand. Now, that was a really brave move. Do you want to talk about the BBC's story and how you're responding to embrace supplier diversity and how it's probably a top-down move?
So, you're right. It is top-down. You know, there is a, like I mentioned before, there is a big drive for diversity and inclusivity as a whole. But just looking at a strain of that, which is supplier diversity, and slightly different to the focus on diversity inclusion in the workplace and the content. It's bringing in what and really facing the challenges that Farida was just talking about there as well, and recognizing, you know, what we actually do. I think we're the more people that I talk to within the BBC, we're actually doing a lot in the space of supply diversity, but we're not actually acknowledging it. So that's the one thing that maybe a lot of organizations are possibly doing already, but not actually acknowledging it. And that's where the definition really comes in as well. But, you know, I think I'm confident enough to say that the most successful organizations know that by creating diversity in their supply chains, you know, all the examples that you're talking about, it can unlock so much innovation, agility, but also improve their ethical credentials as well. You know, it's we understand that it's more than a moral imperative. It brings so much commercial sense, and, you know, drives different culture behaviours, which in turn, you know, drives the organisation that much more forward as well. So we want to build that all into the BBC. We want to build that all into our responsible procurement. We want to build it into, you know, our content, our delivery to the audience, but absolutely acknowledge that it has to be within the core as well. We do understand that procurement plays a key role in diversification and creating the opportunity and moral value that will result from the opportunities in a more flexible and more creative supply base. I think one thing that we all have to be mindful of is the pace at which we do this. I think the passion combined with, you know, the determination to make this happen is wish it was done yesterday, wish we could just bring all the best practice in and, you know, you use all that relevant resources that we have throughout all our research and we could do it yesterday. But that's not possible. So I think pace of rolling this out is key to the outcome and the success of this. So we want it to be purposeful and we want it embedded for the long term. We acknowledge this is evolutionary and it's here to stay. So therefore the pace in this is very, very key, just to make sure that we don't drop anything, we don't disregard any sort of compliance, any key considerations, which, you know, really are different demographically and geographically. But, you know, at the BBC, I think high level, we will be ensuring the inclusion of diverse suppliers as part of our strategic sourcing and procurement process. We will be communicating the value of supplier diversity, both internally and externally, to all our stakeholders. And we're actually seeking out diverse suppliers that can provide competitive, high quality good services that align to our requirements, our vision and our strategy. So that's, you know, that's quite broad, but it's intentional because we want to put a stake in the ground. We want to make this start, and it has to be this high level to really drive that level of pace that we want it to be embedded for the longer term.
Okay, thank you. And same to you, really, Sara. If you want to just give a brief overview of what you're doing at BMS and what you'd like to see done broader to address these challenges. And then I think, Sunita, I'll have to hand back to you to actually talk about the council and what it's actually set up to do. But yeah, if I can go to you first, Sara.
Sure. So as I mentioned, we are expanding our programme, particularly in the UK, and we do support organisations such as We Connect and MSD UK. And we're also putting in place large-scale projects that will bring in a diverse range of suppliers as well. And I think beyond that, we're really trying to, one of the reasons that, you know, I was really passionate about bringing together a council such as this was to really help us try and drive ourselves towards where we are in the US. So really start to have those kind of definitions around diverse suppliers, really ensure that we know how to reach out to the various groups and the organisations that are available to us. I'm still finding groups that I didn't even know existed. And I think that is part of the challenge, is that they are out there and they do need support. But how do we find them and then give them that level of support that that they may need? And that could be, you know, like I said, it's beyond just awarding them business. But there are a number of other ways that we can support these groups. And what I would also love to see is, from a government perspective, some clear definitions and guidance. I'm not sure if we're ready to move to the same point as we are in the US, where it's quite strict around the percentage of spend a corporation has and what their target needs to be for supply diversity. But I do think that we can have better guidance and definitions that are available to us in this market. And wouldn't it be great to have some sort of certification process for corporations who have supply diversity programs in place, so that it really encourages corporations and it recognizes the efforts that corporations are going to really, you know, excel in this area. And from a corporation perspective, and something we're really trying to achieve internally, is to have that top-down approach, which we've got now from our global CEO. But we're also trying to instill that into our objective, so it becomes a corporate objective that then trickles down into every single employee as well. And I think those are the things that we can do to really drive this agenda forward.
That's excellent. Thanks, Sara. So, yeah, Sunita, do you now want to discuss the formation of the council and give a bit of an overview as to the purpose of the council and what we're trying to achieve here? Although obviously I think it's quite clear what we're trying to achieve from the conversation so far. But
no, absolutely, and with enormous pride. You know, we've all talked about the challenges. It's resonated with a lot of people who are attending this today, and those that will listen to it afterwards as well. It's, you know, it's recognizing that gap. It's recognizing that there is a journey, a real appetite to deliver to this. And we've identified that the common theme in all of this is the huge lack of support and guidance. That's what Sara just said just then. And the best practice to really identify with and assist people and organizations with their objective to really drive a diverse supply base. So yes, we all acknowledge that there is no best practice for the UK to drive supply diversity. So we are a group of professionals who are wanting to make a change in supply diversity space and create best practice for the industry. So whilst I'm chairing, I'm joined by founding members Kerry and Sara and Farida here. And more recently, we've welcomed council members across the tree, and they are from Facebook, Accenture, EDF, Vodafone, IBM, and I'm sorry if I haven't mentioned anybody else. But the point here is that, you know, everybody here within the council recognises that there is a genuine passion for supplier diversity. We identify with all the challenges and acknowledge the commitment here. We acknowledge the challenges from a buy side, from a supply side as well. And with the combined experiences and the influence that we have here, ultimately our purpose from the Council for Supply Diversity UK is to provide a corporate support and guidelines to establish a program of work for supplier diversity. So that's that absolutely recognizes and acknowledges there might be differences in sector, in industries, and maybe objectives and agendas. However, this council aims to provide all organizations with equal support to drive their supplier diversity agenda. I think there is resounding need for this across all industries as well as geographies. So we hope to partner and collaborate with other organisations. We're not here to compete with everyone. We're here to absolutely partner and collaborate. because that's the only way supplier diversity will move forward. And hopefully we will collaborate with the Global Technology and Business Services Council in due course as well. And I think it's suffice to say that we'd love to hear from all the participants here today. Everyone out there has a similar passion or agenda or challenge, but I think everybody here really wants to drive this forward. So this is here to stay. We will only evolve and grow regionally, geography to geography. And once we firmly establish this within the UK, we do hope to do that. So we really want people to come forward, get involved, give us any feedback that you've had. Love to hear from you. So yeah, Council for Supplier Diversity UK.
Okay, thank you, Sunita. So obviously the best practice and guidelines on how to do it is key, but I think there are also other challenges and areas for the council to address. So data, benchmarking, what does good look like? You know, those are key challenges. The definition, what is the definition of supplier diversity? So should we pick those up? So I'd be keen to bring both Sara and Farida back in to what do you want this council to achieve? What else is are our objectives?
Okay, so I'm gonna say it from a diverse bias, if you like. It is really to drive more opportunity for diverse suppliers. It is to remove some of those barriers and some of those challenges. It is to create more of a level playing field. And if I'm to be absolutely bluntly honest, is to one day remove this whole thing around supplier diversity, because it shouldn't matter whether you're a woman, whether you're an ethnic minority, whether you're disabled, whether you're a veteran, whether you're old, you know, young, whatever. Everyone should be given the opportunity at the same time, and all of those sort of silos and categories removed completely. And that is ultimately the objective. Whether it will happen in my lifetime, I'm not sure. But I think, you know, ultimately, I want to represent those diverse suppliers that I know for a fact, you know, try day in, day out, and are not fortunate enough to be able to do some of the things that those corporations need. And it's working with them to position them and to help them to become successful, and understand what it takes to become successful and understand what they actually need to do to have more business with those corporates. So that's from my perspective what I'm expecting.
Okay, thank you, Farida. Sara?
Yeah, I echo a lot of what Farida said. I do hope we get to a point where we don't have to have conversations around supplier diversity. And, you know, I think a lot of organisations, particularly over the last year, have really focused on diversity and inclusion internally. And we should really be expanding that. So the inclusion programmes that we all talk about as corporations internally, why would we not extend that externally to the employees that we bring in, to the people that we work with, and to the supply chain that we have, because we, you know, we really have an ownership of that. And so, you know, back to my point, I would like to see corporations really, really focusing on this area and having an incentive to do that through a certification program, for example. And in addition, I think it's really important that, you know, we do sort of talk about this more and more so that we get that out there. And one of the reasons that this council was set up was to really help organisations that might have a gap. So if there is a gap in putting together a programme around supply diversity, that's where we really where we want to focus in, put the right parameters around that gap, and then close it so that any corporation that's coming in to put this type of programme in place really doesn't experience those gaps, because we, you know, we're really here to try and close that off. So I do hope that that's by breaking down those barriers, we'll get to the future that, you know, Farida mentioned, where we don't have to talk about supplier diversity as much as we need to now.
No, absolutely. I think another key area is the collation of benchmark data as well. So I know Andy Horn, hopefully you're there, and he's with EDF and is a member of the council. You know, EDF has done a phenomenal job on actually measuring, you know, the diversity of their suppliers. But then you know, having a certain percentage of SMEs, is that good? Is that, you know, above average or below average? Is the fact that there is no sort of benchmark data to then measure your own performance and diversity and supply chain against. So that's another body of work for this council to do, is to look at collating that data and helping organisations understand what good actually looks like. Now, we are hoping, and we have alluded to it, that we'd like to make this policy, if we could, and we will be asking government to get involved. And we are working with two brands that you didn't mention, Sunita, John Lewis, but also the Cabinet Office. So absolutely delighted to be working with the Cabinet Office, and I think Lindsay's on, so hi Lindsay, how are you doing? Farida, you've been appointed to the Cabinet Office and you've been pretty successful in some of the recent work. Do you want to just give us an overview of that and therefore what our potential aspiration could be?
Yeah, thank you. So yes, I was appointed to the Cabinet Office Small Advisory Business Panel. And really that role is to look into sort of the government and what is going on and how can we improve opportunities for businesses, especially small businesses. And one of the most recent groups that I was involved in was the Prompt Payment Code, which I can't take all the credit for because I only joined kind of on the back end of it. But that was a major success where we've now, it's now sort of policy where those that have signed up to the Prompt Payment Code have to pay SME businesses within 30 days of their invoice. Otherwise, there's penalties to pay for that. And so that was a significant achievement. But what I actually really love about being part of the SME panel in the Cabinet Office is watching how change happens and how people present challenges and what happens and how they go about driving change. And that ultimately is the reason why I'm there. And I'm really hoping and really looking forward to working with Lindsay to look at supply diversity and how can we bring in some policies in place with the government support to drive better practice, and not necessarily go down the quota route, but you know, why is the US successful with supply diversity? Is it because that they've got those targets in place? Is it because they have to meet those obligations? I don't know, but I just can't help but feel that having the support of government, of the Cabinet Office to implement some policy and change is probably what is needed. So from my perspective, that's where I'll be fighting for that.
Excellent, thank you. Right, I think we should probably answer the questions we've got in the chat quickly before we do a summary of what we're all desperate to achieve. So in terms of definition, the definition is a bit of an issue, isn't it? So I was put forward that are we considering the 51% owned and operated principle, or are we adapting that? Who'd like to take that question?
I can start, then feel free, Sara and Farida and Kerry, to chip in. But I think that's the recognised way at the moment, and I think that's what we will encompass and use to start with. And I think with a lot of programmes that are taking some established programs of work over in the US, they may have to follow with that blueprint for now. But as we progress and look at increasing our data, look at increasing what diverse suppliers are out there, that may well change. But I think for now, that's the definition that we'll be using, because that's the one that a lot of organizations kind of work to already. Is that fair to say, Sara, Farida?
Yeah, I think so. And I think also we just need to recognise that although putting in the 51% does help to define diverse suppliers, we also need to just look at organisations that are doing amazing things that might not be owned by that 51% diverse group, but are supporting diversity through their own organisations. And sometimes that's charities, sometimes that's other groups that have been set up. So it does. I think in some cases we do have to be flexible when we come to looking at that 51% ownership.
Yeah, I think it's a good starting point. It's obviously recognised, so it enables us to actually have a benchmark. But really, we want that diversity to be in the fabric and the DNA of the organisation. And hopefully we can evolve to that over time. So next question is really looking at, I think Jason's looking for a plug for his business here, Sunita. So what technologies are you aware of to help buyers identify and assess diverse suppliers? And the same sort of question is actually coming from DD as well, is, you know, how do you find a diverse recruitment company, for example? So what databases are you guys using?
I think that's the problem, isn't it? There isn't like one uniform database that any corporation can go into and magically find a diverse supplier. There are multiple organizations that represent a category, but there isn't sort of like this sort of one-stop shop umbrella that carries all of those categories. And I think that's something that really does need looking at. And I believe the US have something that you can go into, but in the UK, Europe, there isn't. But wouldn't it be amazing if we could just find one global database that you could just punch in recruitment, diverse, woman-owned, whatever, and bang comes your list. Hopefully it soon. But yeah, I think that's the problem, isn't it? There isn't.
Yeah. I think a good starting point for anyone who's looking right now is to reach out to both WeConnect and to MSD UK, because they do have separately hold fantastic databases on different diverse suppliers and the categories that they hold. So if that's a requirement now, I think we'd start there. And then definitely that's one of the things as a council we really want to promote, is that unified database. But it's unified across all aspects of supplier diversity, really.
Thank you. Right, we're nearly at time. So Sunita, how can more people get involved?
We want people to reach out to us. So we all have our individual connections and routes that people will already know. But Kerry, is this a good time to talk about our website?
Yeah.
So people can reach through to us. So we are officially launching our Council for Supplier Diversity UK website. On there, you will find the challenges that we've talked about. Ready, our definition, our purpose, and collaboration support that we hope to lend from a corporate perspective, but also to anyone that's interested in progressing supplier diversity across the UK. We'd love to hear from you on that and really embed your conversations with our agenda, which hopefully does stretch and regard all of that already. So that is one way of reaching and contacting us. But yeah, do feel to contact us on an individual basis if you already have those connections.
Okay, and in addition to that, we are setting up a LinkedIn group as well, where we encourage everybody to get involved in the conversation. So everybody that's joined will receive an email with one, a copy of the webinar, but two, access to the website and the LinkedIn group. So please, please, please do get involved. So I think we're at time. Has anybody got any burning comment that they'd like to share as we sort of close? Covered it all? I think so. So, okay. So thank you all for joining. Please do engage with us. We'd love to hear from you. And have great days. So thank you, Farida. Thank you, Sara. And thank you so much, Sunita. So